This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, The Most Holy Trinosophia. Author, Comte de Saint-Germain. Year, 1933. Part 1. The Man Who Does Not Die. The great Illuminist, Rosicrucian and Freemason, who termed himself the Comte de Saint-Germain, is without question the most baffling personality of modern history. His name was so nearly a synonym of mystery that the enigma of his true identity was as insolvable to his contemporaries as it has been to later investigators. No one questioned the Comte's noble birth or illustrious estate. His whole personality bore the indelible stamp of gentle breeding. The grace and dignity that characterized his conduct, together with his perfect composure in every situation, attested the innate refinement and culture of one accustomed to high station. A London publication makes the following brief analysis of his ancestry. Did he in his old age tell the truth to his protector and enthusiastic admirer, Prince Charles of Hesse Castle? According to the story told by his last friend, he was the son of Prince Rakosi of Transylvania, and his first wife, Atakli. He was placed when an infant, under the protection of the last of the Medici, Gian Gastone. When he grew up and heard that his two brothers, sons of the Princess Hesse Rheinfels of Rothenburg, had received the names of Saint Charles and Saint Elizabeth, he determined to take the name of their holy brother, Saint Germanus. What was the truth? One thing alone is certain, that he was the protege of the last Medici. Caesar Cantu, librarian at Milan, also substantiates the Rakosi hypothesis, adding that Saint Germain was educated in the university at Siena. In her excellent monograph, The Comte de Saint-Germain, The Secret of Kings, Mrs. Cooper Oakley lists the more important names under which this amazing person masqueraded between the years 1710 and 1822. During this time, she writes, we have M. de Saint-Germain as the Marquis de Montferrat, Comte Bellamar or Imar at Venice, Chevalier Schoening at Pisa, Chevalier Weldon at Milan and Leipzig, Comte Soltikoff at Genoa and Leghorn, Graf Zaragi at Schwalbach and Triesdorf, Prinz Rakosi at Dresden, and Comte de Saint-Germain at Paris, The Hague, London, and St. Petersburg. To this list, it may be added that there has been a tendency among mystical writers to connect him with the mysterious Comte de Gabalais, who appeared to the Abbey Villiers and delivered several discourses on submundane spirits. Nor is it impossible that he is the same as the remarkable Signor Gualdi, whose exploits Hargreave Jennings recounts in his book, The Rosicrucians, Their Rites and Mysteries. He is also suspected of being identical with Count Hompesch, the last Grand Master of the Knights of Malta. In personal appearance, the Comte de Saint-Germain has been described as of medium height, well-proportioned in body, and of regular and pleasing features. His complexion was somewhat swarthy, and his hair dark, though often powdered. He dressed simply, usually in black, but his clothes were well-fitting and of the best quality. His eyes possessed a great fascination, and those who looked into them were profoundly influenced. According to Madame de Pompadour, he claimed to possess the secret of eternal youth, and upon a certain occasion claimed having been personally acquainted with Cleopatra, and at another time of having chatted familiarly with the Queen of Sheba. Had it not been for his striking personality and apparently supernatural powers, the Comte would undoubtedly have been considered insane, but his transcending genius was so evident that he was merely termed eccentric. From Souvenirs de Marie Antoinette, by Madame la Comtesse d'Adhémar, we have an excellent description of the Comte, whom Frederick the Great referred to as the man who does not die. It was in 1743 the rumor spread that a foreigner, enormously rich judging by the magnificence of his jewelry, had just arrived at Versailles. Where he came from, no one has ever been able to find out. His figure was well-knit and graceful, his hands delicate, his feet small, and the shapely legs enhanced by well-fitting silk stockings. His nether garments, which fitted very closely, suggested a rare perfection of form. His smile showed magnificent teeth, a pretty dimple marked his chin, his hair was black, and his glance soft and penetrating. And oh, what eyes! Never have I seen their like. He looked about 40 or 45 years old. He was often to be met within the royal private apartments, where he had unrestricted admission at the beginning of 1768. The Comte de Saint-Germain was recognized as an outstanding scholar and linguist of his day. His linguistic proficiency verged on the supernatural. He spoke German, English, Italian, Portuguese, Spanish, French with a Piedmontese accent, Greek, Latin, Sanskrit, Arabic, and Chinese with such fluency that in every land in which he visited, he was accepted as a native. "Learned," writes one author, "speaking every civilized language admirably, a great musician, an excellent chemist, he played the part of a prodigy, and played it to perfection." Even his most relentless detractors admitted that the Comte was possessed of almost incredible attainments in every department of learning. Madame de Pompadour extols the genius of Saint-Germain in the following words: "A thorough knowledge of all languages, ancient and modern, a prodigious memory, erudition, of which glimpses could be caught between the caprices of his conversation, which was always amusing and occasionally very engaging, an inexhaustible skill in varying the tone and subjects of his converse, in being always fresh and in infusing the unexpected into the most trivial discourses, made him a superb talker." Sometimes he recounted anecdotes of the court of the Valois, or of princes still more remote, with such precise accuracy in every detail as almost to create the illusion that he had been an eyewitness to what he narrated. He had traveled the whole world over, and the king lent a willing ear to the narratives of his voyages over Asia and Africa, and to his tales about the courts of Russia, Turkey, and Austria. He appeared to be more intimately acquainted with the secrets of each court than the charge d'affaires of the king. The Comte was ambidextrous to such a degree that he could write the same article with both hands simultaneously. When the two pieces of paper were afterwards placed one upon the other, with the light behind them, the writing on one sheet exactly covered the writing on the other. He could repeat pages of print after one reading. To prove that the two lobes of his brain could work independently, he wrote a love letter with his right hand and a set of mystical verses with his left, both at the same time. He also sang beautifully. By something akin to telepathy, this remarkable person was able to feel when his presence was needed in some distant city or state, and it has even been recorded of him that he had the disconcerting habit of appearing in his own apartments and those of his friends without resorting to the conventionality of the door. He was, by some curious circumstances, a patron of railroads and steamboats. Franz Grieffer, in his Recollections of Vienna, recounts the following incident in the life of the astonishing Comte. Saint-Germain then gradually passed into a solemn mood. For a few seconds he became rigid as a statue. His eyes, which were always expressive beyond words, became dull and colorless. Presently, however, his whole being became reanimated. He made a movement with his hand as if in signal of departure, then said, "I am leaving, ich scheide, do not visit me. Once again, will you see me? Tomorrow night I am off. I am much needed in Constantinople, then in England, there to prepare two inventions which you will have in the next century, trains and steamboats." As an historian, the Comte possessed an uncanny knowledge of every occurrence of the preceding 2,000 years, and in his reminiscences he described in intimate detail events of the previous centuries in which he had played important roles. He spoke of scenes at the court of Francis I as if he had seen them, describing exactly the appearance of the king, imitating his voice, manner, and language, affecting throughout the character of an eyewitness. In like style, he edified his audience with pleasant stories of Louis XIV, and regaled them with vivid descriptions of places and persons. See All the Year Round. Most of Saint-Germain's biographers have noted his peculiar habits with regard to eating. It was diet, he declared, combined with his marvelous elixir, which constituted the true secret of longevity, and although invited to the most sumptuous repasts, he resolutely refused to eat any food but such as had been specially prepared for him and according to his recipes. His food consisted mostly of oatmeal, groats, and the white meat of chicken. He is known on rare occasions to have taken a little wine, and he always took the most elaborate precautions against the possibility of contracting cold. Frequently invited to dinner, he devoted the time during which he naturally should have eaten to regaling the other guests with tales of magic and sorcery, unbelievable adventures in remote places, and intimate episodes from the lives of the great. In one of his tales concerning vampires, Saint-Germain mentioned in an offhand way that he possessed the wand or staff with which Moses brought water from the rock, adding that it had been presented to him at Babylon during the reign of Cyrus the Great. The memoir writers admit themselves at a loss as to how many of the Comte's statements could be believed. Common sense, as then defined, assured them that most of the accounts must be fashioned out of whole cloth. On the other hand, his information was of such precise nature, and his learning so transcendent in every respect, that his words carried the weight of conviction. Once, while relating an anecdote regarding his own experiences at some remote time, and suddenly failing to recollect clearly what he considered a relevant detail, he turned to his valet and said, "Am I not mistaken, Roger?" The good man instantly replied, "Monsieur le Comte forgets that I have only been with him for 500 years. I could not, therefore, have been present at that occasion. It must have been my predecessor." The smallest doings of so unusual a person as Saint-Germain would, of course, be meticulously noted. Several interesting and amusing bits of information are available relative to the establishment which he maintained in Paris. He had two valets de chambre. The first, Roger, already mentioned, and the second, a Parisian engaged for his knowledge of the city and other useful local information. Besides this, his household consisted of 4 lackeys in snuff-colored livery and gold braiding. He hired a carriage at 500 francs a month. As he often changed his coats and waistcoats, he had a rich and expensive collection of them, but nothing approached the magnificence of his buttons, studs, watches, rings, chains, diamonds, and other precious stones. Of these he possessed a very large value, and varied them every week. Meeting Saint-Germain one day at dinner, Baron Gleichen chanced to focus the conversation upon Italy, and had the good fortune to please Saint-Germain, who, turning to him, remarked, "I have taken a great fancy to you, and will show you 12 pictures, the like of which you have not seen in Italy." In the words of Gleichen, "Actually, he almost kept his word, for the pictures he showed me were all stamped either with singularity or perfection, which rendered them more interesting than many first-class works. Above all was a Holy Family by Murillo, equal in beauty to that by Raphael at Versailles. But he showed me other wonders, a large quantity of jewels and colored diamonds of extraordinary size and perfection. I thought I beheld the treasures of the wonderful lamp. Among other gems were an opal of monstrous size, and a white sapphire, as large as an egg, which by its brilliancy dimmed all the stones compared with it. I flatter myself that I am a connoisseur in gems, but I can declare that it was impossible to perceive any reason for doubting the genuineness of these jewels, the more so that they were not mounted." As an art critic, Saint-Germain could instantly detect the most cleverly perpetrated forgeries. He did considerable painting himself, achieving an incredible brilliance of color. He was so successful that Van Loo, the French artist, begged him to divulge the secret of his pigments, but he refused. He is accredited with having secured astonishing results in the painting of jewelry by mixing powdered mother-of-pearl with his colors. What occurred to his priceless collection of paintings and jewels after his death or disappearance is unknown. It is possible that the Comte's chemical knowledge comprehended the manufacture of luminous paint such as is now used on watch dials. His skill as a chemist was so profound that he could remove flaws from diamonds and emeralds, which feat he actually performed at the request of Louis XV in 1757. Stones of comparatively little value were thus transformed into gems of the first water, after remaining for a short time in his possession. He frequently performed this last experiment, if the statements of his friends can be relied upon. There is also a popular story to the effect that he placed gems worth thousands of dollars on the place cards at the banquets he gave. It was in the court at Versailles that the Comte de Saint-Germain was brought face to face with the elderly Comtesse de Gergy. Upon beholding the celebrated magician, the aged lady stepped back in amazement, and the following well-authenticated conversation took place between the two. 50 years ago, the Comtesse said, I was ambassadress at Venice and I remember seeing you there looking just as you do now, only somewhat riper in age perhaps, for you have grown younger since then. Bowing low, the Comte answered with dignity, I have always thought myself happy in being able to make myself agreeable to the ladies. Madame de Gurgi then continued, You then called yourself the Marquis Baletti. The Comte bowed again and replied, And Comtesse Gurgi's memory is still as good as it was 50 years ago. The Comtesse smiled. That I owe to an elixir you gave me at our first meeting. You are really an extraordinary man. Saint-Germain assumed a grave expression. Did this Marquis Baletti have a bad reputation? He asked. On the contrary, replied the Comtesse, he was in very good society. The Comte shrugged his shoulders expressively saying, Well, as no one complains of him, I adopt him willingly as my grandfather. The Comtesse d'Adhémar was present during the entire conversation, and vouches for its accuracy in every detail. Madame du Hausset, femme de chambre to Madame de Pompadour, writes at some length of the astonishing man who often called upon her mistress. She records a conversation which took place between La Pompadour and Saint-Germain. It is true, madame, that I knew Madame de Gurgi long ago, the Comte affirmed quietly. But according to that, replied the Marquise, you must now be more than 100 years old. That is not impossible, enigmatically returned the Comte with a slight smile, but I admit that it is more possible that this lady, for whom I have infinite respect, talks nonsense. It was answers such as this which led Gustave Bourde to write of Saint-Germain that he allows a certain mystery to hover about him, a mystery which awakens curiosity and sympathy. Being a virtuoso in the art of misleading, he says nothing that is untrue. He has the rare gift of remaining silent and profiting by it. See La Franque Masonry and France, etc. But to return to Madame du Hausset's story. You gave Madame de Gurgi, pressed La Pompadour, an elixir surprising in its effects. She pretends that for a long while she appeared to be no older than 24. Why should you not give some to the king? Saint-Germain allowed an expression feigning terror to spread over his face. Ah! Madame, I should be mad indeed to take it into my head to give the king an unknown drug. The Comte was on very friendly terms with Louis XV, with whom he had long discussions on the subject of precious stones, their manufacture and purification. Louis was amused and thrilled by turns. Never before had so extraordinary a person trod the sacred precincts of Versailles. The whole court was topsy-turvy and miracles were the order of the day. Courtiers of depleted fortunes envisioned the magical multiplication of their gold, and granddames of uncertain age had dreams of youth and favor restored by the mystery man's fabled elixirs. It is easy to understand how so fascinating a character could relieve the boredom of a king, who had spent his life a martyr to royal fashions and was deprived by his position of the pleasure of honest work. Then again, rulers become victims to the fads of the moment, and Louis himself was dabbling in alchemy and other occult arts. True, the king was only a dilettante, whose will was not strong enough to bind him to any lasting purpose, but Saint-Germain appealed to several qualities in the royal nature. The Comte's fund of knowledge, the skill with which he assembled his facts, to the amusement and edification of his audiences, the mystery which surrounded his appearances and disappearances, his consummate skill both as a critic and technician in the arts and sciences, to say nothing of his jewels and wealth, endeared him to the king. Had Louis but profited by the wisdom and prophetic warnings of the
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.